Welcome back to PC301 workshop, and we start with the second session of the fifth day. And we have with us Professor Fahad Panolan from Indian Institute of Technology, Hyderabad, and he'll be talking about geometric decomposition. Thank you for joining us, Fahad. Over to you now.
Okay. Thanks for the introduction. So I will be talking about, you know, decomposition on geometric, one particular geometric graph, which is unitless graph, and this can be extended to some other like unit square graph, and some of the results are also extendable to you know, higher dimensions, but we will stick on something called unitless graph. Okay, and so we know that, you know, tree decomposition is one of the most, you know, algorithmically used graph decomposition. And in this talk, what we will be seeing is like we'll be seeing some kind of a tree decomposition where we will not be bounding the width as such, but the tree decomposition will have some structure. The structure is like each bag is a union of few clicks. Okay, and then exploit that structure to design good algorithms. Okay, and throughout this this talk, we will be restricting on two special graph classes. One is planar graph and the other is unitless graph. Okay, and in the planar graph, most of these decomposition theorems are known for, you know, long time ago itself, and for unitless graph, this is comparably new. Okay, like in last two decades. And then like what kind of theorems we will be seeing is something called grid minor theorems, or like vertex or edge decomposition theorem, and if time permits, then contraction decomposition as well. And the core of all of this is like some kind of a tree decomposition, some kind of a structured tree decomposition. Okay, and in this talk, if I'm using any term which you don't know or you don't remember now, you feel free to stop me and ask. I will explain it. Okay. Okay. So before moving into, you know, various, you know, explaining formally what these graph classes are and defining these special kind of tree decompositions, I will just name few problems which we will be using throughout the talk. Okay, so our decompositions, we will use these decompositions to solve algorithmic problems, and some of the problems are listed here. So we will be applying those decomposition on these problems. Okay, and we will not be using click to, so click is, you know, very easy on these two graph classes, so I just named it here, and I will be mentioning it's a result only. Okay, so the in the click problem, you know, want to output a click of size at least k. The input is always a graph g, and if it is a parameterized problem, then there will be an integer k also as input, and the output in the click problem is a click of size at least k. Okay, or like, you know, k vertices, between every pair of them there is an edge between them. That is what click is. Okay, and the other problem we will be considering in this talk is vertex cover. You all know that, like, you know, a few vertices, k at most k vertices that cover all the edges. And the third problem is feedback vertex set, the set of vertices that hits all the cycles in the graph. Okay, so in the feedback vertex set problem, we want, you know, a feedback vertex set of size at most k. And then there is a, you know, variant of cycle problem, which is like, one is called exact cycle, where the input is a graph g and an integer k, and we want to output a s if there is a cycle of length exactly k. Okay, and there is another notion which is called the long cycle, and in the long cycle we want to say yes if or like we need to output a cycle which is whose length is at least k. And the another cycle problem is Hamiltonian cycle, where we want a cycle of length exactly n, where n is the number of vertices, or in other words, like a cycle that visits every vertex exactly once. Okay, and the final problem I want to introduce is like a mean bisection. I think you might have seen it in the last talk, Okay, if not, then here is the definition. So given a graph on n vertices, assume that n is even, and you want to partition into two parts A and B. Both A contains n by 2 vertices, B contain n by 2 vertices, and what you need is and what you want is like the crossing edges between A and B to be minimized. So I want to find out a bisection, which means that partition into two of equal size, such that the number of crossing edges is at most k. So these are the problems we will be, you know, using in this talk. Okay. Now, so as I mentioned, we will be restricting on two graph classes in this talk. One is planar graph, and the other is unit disk graph. Okay. And what is, just recall that what is planar graph? If you are able to embed that a graph on a plane without crossing the edges, when you draw curves for edges, it should not cross. Okay, if such an embedding exists, then that is called a planar graph. For example, the left hand side graph is a planar graph, and on the right hand side, no matter whichever possible way you draw this graph, which is a complete graph on five vertices, you will not be able to draw in a plane without crossing at least a pair of edges. Okay, and So notice that actually means that in a planar graph, you cannot have a large click of size 5 or more. And that actually tells, like, you know, the click can be solved very easily on planar graph. The maximum size of a click is 4, and you just need to try all possible vertices of set of size 4. Okay, and given a graph G, like in the sense given an adjacency list or adjacency matrix of a graph, testing whether that graph is a planar or not, that problem is called planarity testing, and that can be done in linear time, order n time. And for all the many of the problems I listed in the previous slide, which is like vertex cover, feedback vertex set, exact or long or Hamiltonian cycle, these are all NP hard problems. And one of the problem I mentioned there, which is minimum bisection, that we don't know whether it is in poly time or NP hard on planar graph. So that question is still open. Okay, and now move on to the definition of unit disk graph. Okay, what is a unit disk graph? It is an intersection graph of unit circles in the plane. So think that, you know, I have a lot of unit disk. Unit disk means its radius is 1. Okay, or like a circle whose radius is 1. Okay, and you can draw a graph as follows. For every vertex, for every unit disk, you just draw a vertex, and you just take a point which is the center of that unit disk on the plane, and you will be adding, you know, edges between these two points on the plane, and if they are at a distance at most, you know, 2. Okay, so, or in other words, the corresponding unit disk intersect, then you will draw an edge between those two vertices. And notice that here, like, I don't know, can I rotate it? Okay, this portion, like, there is a large click. Okay, so unit disk graphs are like not planar, like highly, it could be highly non-planar. There is a large click. A large click can be part of a unit disk graph. So if you are given a complete graph, that complete graph can be represented as a unit disk graph, because you take n unit disk graph, unit disk, and keep one on top of everything, and then that unit disk graph, like represented by those unit disk, will be a complete graph. So this is highly non-planar graphs. Okay, and what are the look at the problems I mentioned along with unit disk graph testing. Like, unit disk graph testing means, given a graph G, where the input is like an adjacency list or adjacency matrix of a graph, and I want to test whether there is a whether this is a unit, this graph, or like can I get to, you know, can I place n unit circles on the plane, and if I take the intersection graph of these circles, then that graph is same as my input graph, and that question is NP-hard. And for the click, and this is unlike the case of planarity testing, that can be done in linear time. And for the click problem, there is a robust polynomial time algorithm exists. What do I mean by robust polynomial time algorithm? Given a graph G, not necessarily a unit disk representation of a unit disk graph, just a adjacency list of a graph, it will either output a maximum click in it, or it will say that the given graph is not a unit disk graph. Okay, one of them will, like, it will does one of them, and output will be correct. Okay, and so even without getting a representation of a unit, okay, or a unit disk representation, there is an algorithm which solves click in polynomial time on unit disk graphs, and all other problems which I listed before, they are like a vertex cover and a feedback vertex set, and those cycle problem, Hamiltonian cycle or long cycle or exact cycle, and mean bisection, they are all NP-hard. Notice that mean bisection is open on planar graph. The classical complexity of mean bisection on planar graph is open. And so in the case of unit disk graph, we can think like the input can be of two kinds. One is like this unit disk representation is given to us, okay, that is one kind, and the other is like this representation is not given, we are given just a graph, like in the sense, in the form of an adjacency list or adjacency matrix, and probably a guarantee is also given, okay, this will form a unit disk graph. And then can we solve different problems on those graph? Okay. Is there any question?
There's a question in the chat.
Ah, okay.
Can you see it, or shall I read out for you?
Ah, I can see. So the algorithm you mentioned for click would run for any general graph, just not at point in time. Okay. The algorithm can output one of those things. Either it can output a max click, or it can say like it proves that it is not a unit disk graph. Okay, so if you give a general graph, it may be outputting a proof that it is not a unit disk graph. So it may not be giving you a click all the time. So if the input is already a unit disk graph, then what you will get is, you know, always a maximum click. Is there any more, anything more? Okay. Now, before moving into different kind of decomposition, which we will see in this talk, I will explain you some useful properties of unit disk graphs. And then that can be used, you know, very quickly to get some ideas or proofs of those decompositions. Okay. So notice that, like, I can represent a unit disk graph as follows, right? So for every unit circle, I will place a point at the center of that unit circle, and those those points represent vertices, and between two points, you will draw an edge if their distance is at most 2, okay? So the radius is 1, okay? Now, so I can draw a cell, a grid like this, where every cell has diameter length 2, which means that the other sides have length square root 2, and it cover all the, you know, every point which represent this unit disk will be in one of the cells, okay? And what is the property of this kind of a drawing? If I look into a particular cell, all the points within that particular cell is at a distance at most 2. which means that all the vertices within a cell form a clique. Okay, that is one property. So every look at every cell or that form a clique in the graph. Okay, and there is also another property. Look at any edge in the unit this graph. Okay. And that cannot, and say point like, you know, point X and point Y. X represent a center of a unit disk and Y represent another center of a unit disk. And this X and Y cannot be too far, right? Its distance is at most 2. And which means that the cells are also very close. It can be the cell distance is at most 2. Okay. So the edges are like, there is no edge from a cell in the leftmost to something on the, you know, fourth column. So it can go at most, you know, one or two distance. So this kind of a decomposition I can draw, like, so, or in other words, I can come up with a decomposition where every cell, like look into each of these cell, those vertices, okay, like, and if I collect those vertices, that will form a partition, and each of the part is a clique. And from one part, I will be having only vertices to constant number of other cliques, because it will be seeing, it will have vertices which are adjacent in the cells which are close by. Okay. And if anything is not clear in this explanation, please let me know. Okay. So this kind of a, you know, a cell partitioning is possible for a unit disk graph, assuming if a representation is given, we can draw it. If a representation is not given, we cannot draw it, but that exists because there exists a representation. Okay, and this is also called something called a clique grid graph, because in each cell it form a clique and the whole structure look like a grid. Okay. Now, one of the important thing which we will use later is a special kind of a minor exists for a unit disk graph. Okay, how do I construct this special kind of minor? Look at this cell partition of a unit disk graph. Okay, and each cell forms a clique. I just contract all the edges within a cell, or I've used the notation and say like, contract vertices in that cell. Okay, by that I mean all the edges within that cell you just contract. Okay, and then what you get, you will get a graph which is called, which you just name it H. Okay, and H is a minor of G, and H has the following property, right? The max degree of H is a constant, because you know use the fact that, you know, a vertex in a cell can see vertices in somewhat nearby cells, like which is cell distance will be at most 2. Okay, using that you can see that in this graph H, which is a minor I constructed here, has constant max degree. Okay, and notice that this H may not be a unit disk graph, because you know, contraction operation may not preserve this property, unit disk graph property. Okay, so the graph H may not be a unit disk graph, but one can also prove that H is a minor of a bounded degree subgraph G prime of G. Okay, how do we prove it? Like, you just mark a constant number of vertices from every cell with the following property. Okay, so I just mark a few vertices in each cell. They are marked using red colors. Okay, if I have a edge between cell A and cell B, there exists a marked vertex in cell A and there exists a marked vertex in cell B, such that there is an edge between them. Okay, and again using the previous property, you can prove that you can mark only constant number of vertices in each cell such that this property hold. Now, instead of now you can also prove that H is actually a minor of the graph induced on these red vertices. Just for concentrate on the graph induced on the red vertices, and you contract those red vertices, like those vertices which are the marked vertices in each cell, like, and for that graph, like what you get, the resulting graph is also H. So and so that graph, the graph induced on red vertices is the G prime, and H is a minor of G prime, and yeah, and G prime is an induced subgraph of G. Okay, so for a unit this graph, I can get a, you know, a G prime which is an induced subgraph of G, whose, you know, max degree is constant, and H is a minor of that unit disk graph, okay, where H I obtained by contracting the each cell, okay, each cell vertices, okay, and yeah, so this is one special kind of a you know, minor which exists for a unit disk graph G, which we will use later, okay. And here I want to mention that if unit disk representation is given, then I can construct this G prime as well as H very easily. I just need to draw this cell, and I just need to contract this, or I just need to mark these red vertices. This can be done in polynomial time, and so the all these objects can be found in polynomial time if a representation, a unit disk representation, is given to us. Okay. Now, so what happens if such a representation is not given to us? Okay, such a representation is not given to us. Okay, in that case, we can also get something. We can also get a H with a slightly weaker property. Okay, that is as follows. Okay, okay. You just pick an arbitrary vertex, and the arbitrary vertex here is like say this orange vertex, okay, and then look at all the neighbors of that orange vertex and call it v1, and then pick another vertex, you know, v2, which is not at either the orange or its neighbors, and then pick all the neighbors of it, which is the blue vertices, call it v2, and similarly you go. You keep making these, you know, vertex sets v1 v2 like that. Okay, so essentially how you make, you pick an arbitrary vertex v1, so you don't need to have this unit disk representation to do this operation. So you just pick an arbitrary vertex v1, and then like capital v1 is the neighborhood of v1, like close neighborhood of v1, and then you pick v2 which is not in v1, and then take the close neighborhood of v2 minus v1 and name it v2, and similarly v3 will be like something which is not in v1 or v2, and then close neighborhood of it minus v1 union v2, and you apply this process, you will get v1 v2 etc up to, you know, some partition. Okay, and you contract each of these vi, and what you will get is a minor of the graph, and this graph will also have constant degree. Okay, you can prove it, like it is pretty much similar to the previous construction, but you know, instead of one cell, there will be constantly many cells are involved in it. Okay, using that you can prove that this H has a, you know, order, the max degree of this H is a constant. Okay, so and another property is this H. And look at each vi. Okay, now what, each vi may not be a clique, because not is here, like the green vertices, all the green vertices together may not form a clique. Okay, but look at these green vertices which are like restricted on the different cells, they will form a clique. So each, because of that, each vi can be seen as a union of constantly many cliques. So previously each vi is a clique, now in this case each vi is a union of constant number of cliques. Okay, so that is like a slight weakness here. So each vi is a constant number, union of constant number of cliques, and the graph h has max degree constant. Okay, And we had a third property, and the third property was saying that, okay, this H is also a minor of a unit disk graph, which was a subgraph, you induced a subgraph of the original graph. We cannot get the whole thing, but we can get something similar, which like H is a minor of a constant degree unit disk graph G prime, and this G prime may not be an induced subgraph of the original graph G. How to get it? The argument is very clear, very simple. Okay, so look at this orange vertices, like orange vertices are small v1, small v2, etc. Okay, and from that orange vertex, draw a circle of radius 4. Okay, keep doing it. Okay, now think that these big circles form, you know, a disk. Each of them has radius 4, and this will form an intersection graph, right? Intersection graph of these disk, and H will be a minor of this intersection graph. Big disk intersection graph. And moreover, each of the disk here has radius 4. And this implies that by shrinking every length to 1, I can think of this as a unit disk graph. So this graph, like the intersection graph of this degree 4 unit circles, is also a unit disk graph, that is G prime. And this G prime may not be an induced subgraph of G, or in many cases it is not an induced subgraph of G, but it is a unit disk graph. Okay. So this is what we have. If a unit disk representation is given, in poly time, I can get, you know, a partition V1, V2, etc. up to VL, and each VI is a click, and the graph obtained by contracting each of these blocks, I will get a minor H of G, and the degree of it, the max degree is constant. Moreover, H is a minor of a constant degree unit disk graph G prime, and that G prime is also an induced subgraph of G. And if the representation is not given to us in poly time, I can come up with a partition V1, V2, VL. And here each VI may not be a click, but it is a union of constantly many clicks. And by contracting each VI, I will get a graph H, and that will have constant degree. And H is a minor of a constant degree unit disk graph G prime, and this G prime may not be a subgraph of original G. Okay, so this much we can get, like, from the structure of unit disk graph, and what happened when a representation is given, what happened when a representation is not given. Yeah. Now ask ourselves what about tree decompositions of these graph classes. We all know that for planar graph, there is a tree decomposition of width at most square root n. Okay, and this you can easily get it from, you know, something called a linear grid theorem. Okay, or otherwise also, like, it's a true statement. Okay, for any planar graph, its tree width is at most, you know, order square root n. And so, given this, we can, you know, solve many of the problems listed there. Okay, I don't have to solve click, because click is poly time solvable on both the graph classes. Okay, so forget about click. And vertex cover, I can solve it in time, you know, 2 to the power order square root n, a standard dynamic programming on tree decomposition. Okay, now if you apply the linear vertex kernel, and then on that kernel, if you do tree decomposition, if the input graph was a planar graph, then you can solve vertex cover in time 2 to the order square root k time. And for feedback vertex set, and, you know, and those variants of cycle problem, by standard dynamic programming algorithm on a tree decomposition of width square root n, you can solve it in time 2 to the power order square root n log n. And if you use some sophisticated technique like cut and count or representative families or other techniques are also there, then you can solve those problems as well in time 2 to the power order square root. And a standard dynamic programming algorithm will give mean bisection in time 2 to the power order square root. Okay, so this is about, you know, planar graph and its normal tree width or tree decomposition. And what about unit disk graph? Can we get a tree decomposition whose width is at most, you know, order square root n? No, that is not possible. The reason is you take a complete graph on n vertices, and that's a unit disk graph. How that is a unit disk graph? You just take n unit disk and keep one on top of one on top of the other, and then that representation will give you a complete graph. So a complete graph is a unit disk graph, and for that the tree width is n. So unit disk graph, we don't have that, you know, square root n tree width bound. Is there any question? Okay. Now, but notice that a complete graph has a 3D composition, which has only one back, and it is a click. Okay, so it's a very nice 3D composition. Okay, and now I will talk about one special kind of a 3D composition, which is like a 3D composition where every back is a click. One particular graph class has this property. And okay, do you know which one it is? A 3D composition where every back is a click. It's a chordal graph, okay? And using that, you can prove, you know, some result, you know, in poly time. Try to do a dynamic programming on such 3D composition for some problems, you will get, you know, poly time algorithm. Okay, for example, vertex cover. So that is chordal graph. Okay, but in the case of unit disk graph, we can prove the following. Okay, a unit disk graph has a tree decomposition where every bag is a union of order square root n clicks. Okay, and such a decomposition can be computed in time, you know, 2 to the power order square root n as well. Okay, even if we are not given a unit disk representation. Okay. And also it has some additional property. The additional property is this. Okay, you collect all those clicks in every back together. Now look at each click. Now this click can have neighbors in at most constantly many other clicks. Okay, so each click will have neighbors in at most constantly many other clicks. Okay, that is one additional property. And the other important property is every back, look at the 3D composition where every back is a union of order square root n clicks. Now using that, we can, you know, design good dynamic programming algorithms. Like try to solve vertex cover on such a 3D composition. Look at a click. From a click, I need to pick all but one, right? So look, concentrate on a back. I need to pick all but one from a click, which means that the number of states for a particular bag will be like n to the power square root n, or n to the power order square root n. Using that, you know, if you design a dynamic programming algorithm, you will get, you know, an algorithm running in time 2 to the power order square root n log n. And if you do, you know, the linear vertex kernel, which actually will give you an induced subgraph of the original graph, so that will be again a unit disk graph, and then if you are going to apply the above algorithm, you can solve vertex cover in time 2 to the power order square root k log k time. And for the feedback vertex set, it's a feedback vertex set. Okay, for the feedback vertex set problem, you can solve it in time 2 to the order square root n log n, because look at a back. And each bag is a union of square root n clicks. And from each of the click, you have to pick all but at most two vertex in that click into the solution. So for many of the vertices, like, you know, if there are C vertices, except two for the remaining vertex should go into the feedback vertex set. Using that again, you can, you know, say that the number of states is bounded by, you know, n to the power order square root n. Okay, square root n is the number of clicks in a bag. And using that, you can prove that, you know, feedback vertex set can be solved in this much time. Okay, and what happens when there is an exact or like this cycle problem? I just concentrate on say long cycle. I want to say that is there a cycle of length at least k? Okay, and now suppose I have, you know, take any graph and I have two clicks, which is, you know, in the look at the left hand side picture, and those ellipses represent two clicks. Okay, and look at a cycle that look like what is drawn in this figure. Okay, and I can just redraw this one in such a way that these two red cross edges are inside the click. Like I can delete those two red cross edges and then add those green edges, and still that will be a cycle of you know, previous, what is the length of the previous cycle? Suppose that is L, then the right hand side, that cycle also have the length L. Okay, and more, okay, what is the important thing we are doing here is like the number of cross edges between, you know, two clicks can be reduced. So if there are two like this, I can just draw like this and then get a new cycle where the number of cross edges will be less. Okay, so formally what we can prove is, okay, if I have a cycle and I have two clicks and there are lot of edges crossing between them, I can reroute in such a way that the number of cross edges in the new cycle will be a constant. Okay, so an example of such rerouting is shown in this figure. Okay, now, so the number of edges, okay, now think about, you know, your long cycle solution. Okay, and think about your tree decomposition where every bag is a union of click. Okay, and every bag is a union of click, and if you pick any two clicks, which is like one in this bag, one in maybe in future, the number of cross edges is constant. Okay, and the other additional property I have mentioned is like one click is adjacent to at most order one other clicks. Okay, which actually means that, you know, I can have a solution where the number of edges going out of a click to other clicks is actually a constant. Okay, and each bag is a union of order square root n clicks. Use all these three facts, and then if we design a dynamic programming algorithm where instead of looking for a cycle where between two clicks there are lot of cross edges, we will look for only solutions where between two clicks I will be using only constant number of cross edges, then that dynamic programming algorithm will have few states than, you know, all possible you know, n to the power order n states. Instead of that, we will have like n to the power order square root n states. And so like a bit tedious work, using that you can get a dynamic programming algorithm where the running time is 2 to the power order square root n log n. Okay, okay, so we have seen some kind of a tree decomposition where every bag is a union of clicks and the number of clicks that is bounded, right, that is square root n for a unit disk graph. Okay, now we'll see grid minor theorems. Okay, one of the famous grid minor theorem is grid minor theorem on planar graph. Planar graph admit linear grid minor theorem. Okay, what does it mean? For any planar graph G and an integer L, either there is a L times L grid minor of G, or the tree width of the graph is bounded by order L. Okay, so either there is a L times L grid minor, or there is a, or the tree width of it is bounded by order L. Okay, now we can use this fact to design good algorithms. Okay, and such algorithms are called bidimensional algorithms. Okay, so like, see an example. Like, look at a vertex cover or a feedback vertex set problem. Suppose my graph has a two square root k times two square root k grid minor. Then this minor will the vertex cover number of this minor will be, you know, more than k. And if the vertex cover number of the minor is more than k, then the vertex cover number of the original graph is also more than k, and hence it will be a null instance. And if that is not the case, I know that its tree width is bounded by order square root k, and you know, run your dynamic programming algorithm on that tree decomposition, you can solve it in time 2 to the power order square root k. And look at the long cycle problem. Suppose there is a grid minor of dimension square root k times square root k. Okay, you can find a cycle in that grid minor whose length is at least k. Okay, and then okay, if that is not the case, okay, so if there is a large grid minor, then it is a yes instance. If that is not the case, then the tree width is bounded by order square root k, and you run your dynamic programming algorithm on it, and you will get to 2 to the order square root k time if you use, you know, techniques like, you know, cut and count or metroid based techniques. Otherwise it will be k to the power order square root k. This kind of property is called bidimensionality. Like if the grid minor size is large, then something will happen. I can say the answer to the I can correctly say that an answer to my question. Otherwise its tree width is bounded, then I will be using dynamic programming algorithm on that tree decomposition. Okay, and this property is called bidimensionality property. Okay, and can I use the same technique to solve exact cycle? What is exact cycle problem? Given a graph G on planar graph, I'm talking about only planar graph. Given a planar graph, is there a cycle of length exactly k? Can I use the above technique to get it? What do you think? The same method? Does it work? Okay, so since time is less, I will say we cannot use the same method to get an exact cycle problem, because if I have a k cycle in a minor, that doesn't mean that I have a k cycle in the original graph. Okay, so even if I have a k cycle in a grid minor, then that does not imply that there is a k cycle in the original graph, but there will be a cycle of length at least k in the original graph. So because of that, I cannot use exact cycle on this using this technique. Okay. Now, so for unit disk graph, okay, what kind of grid theorem is known? Okay, so if the unit disk graph has a constant max degree, then we can get a linear grid theorem. Okay. Given a unit disk graph G of max degree delta and a positive integer L, either there is a L times L grid minor, or there is a tree decomposition of width order L. You think that delta is a constant, okay, then order L. And this can be done in time 2 to the power order L. Okay, if you are given a unit disk representation. Okay. Now, from theorem 1, we can easily prove theorem 2. Okay, what is theorem 2 says? Either there is a L times L grid minor for a unit disk graph, or there is a tree decomposition where every bag is a union of order L clicks, and this can be decided in time, you know, 2 to the power order L. And this additional property which we talked about, each click can see, you know, can have neighbors in constantly many other clicks, this additional property will also hold. because of lack of time, I may not give you the proof from theorem 1 to theorem 2. What you need to use is so we have constructed this graph H, which is a constant degree minor, and we have also constructed a G prime, which is a constant degree induced subgraph of G. And so what one can do is one can apply the theorem 1 on G prime and prove theorem 2. Okay, since lack of time, I will skip that. Okay. So now we can apply, you know, theorem 2 to get good algorithms. Okay. Now again, you just look for vertex cover or feedback vertex set. If there is a large grid minor, then definitely for any graph, the vertex cover size is, you know, at least k. That is the same case with feedback vertex set as well. Okay, you can try to work out. You will be able to get, you know, k disjoint cycle or more than k plus one disjoint cycles, and that cannot be hit by k vertices. And otherwise, what you do, you apply dynamic programming algorithm, and you will solve it in time 2 to the power order square root k log k. And so for long cycle, if there is a square root k times square root k grid minor, then, you know, there is a cycle of length at least k in that minor, which means that there is a cycle of length at least k in the original graph. So we are done. And otherwise, we can do, you know, a dynamic programming algorithm on the tree decomposition, where each bag is a union of, you know, order square root k clicks. Okay. So there, you apply the same algorithm which we have explained, with running time, you know, 2 to the order square root n log n. That same algorithm here, instead of square root n clicks in a bag, we have square root k clicks in a bag. Then we will get something like this. Okay, so since we have seen a similar algorithm with instead of k there is n, so I will just move on to the next. Okay, so we can get something called, you know, grid minor theorem on unit disk graph. Now there is another thing, another kind of decomposition which is called vertex or edge decomposition. So there are two decomposition. One is vertex decomposition and the other is edge decomposition. So I will stick on to vertex decomposition. Okay. Now, what is this vertex decomposition? Okay. For a planar graph, given a planar graph G and a positive integer W, in Pauli time we can, you know, partition V of G into W plus one sets. Okay, so V of G can be partitioned into blocks, like how many blocks? W plus one blocks. And deleting any one of them, like if you pick any one of the sets and delete it, its tree width will be order W. Or in other words, you know, take a graph induced on any W of these sets, its tree width will be order one. Order W. Okay, and you know, such a decomposition exists for planar graph, and this is, you know, done using something called Becker's technique. And this is applied both in approximation algorithms and parameterized algorithms to get good algorithm, to get good efficient algorithms. But we will stick on to unit disk graph. Okay, something similar we can get it for unit disk graph, and that is as follows: given a unit disk graph G, and you know a positive integer W, we can partition this into W plus one sets. Okay, and deleting any one of them will give you a tree decomposition where each bag width may not be bounded, but each bag is a union of order W clicks, and this we can compute it in Pauli time. Okay, and this proof we will see it now. Okay, so recall our, you know, decomposition into recall the cell partition of the unit disk graph. Okay, like every point corresponding to vertex will be in one of the cells, each cell from a click, and there are no edges from a cell one to, you know, far away cell, like it will be close by. And we do, you know, we give a number for each of these columns, like first two I will give a label one, the second two I will give label two, and like that, and w, and then I will get w plus one, and then again I will repeat the same numbering, like the next two, one, and then two, three, etc. I will get w plus one, and then one, two, like that. Okay, now suppose you delete, you know, any of these vertices in one of the sets. Okay, which are the sets from? Okay, the vertices in which are labeled one are like v1. The vertices which are labeled two are v2, and like that. Okay, so I got a partition into w plus one, you know, parts. And you pick any label, say two, and you just delete it. Okay, and then each of these portions like will be disconnected, like the leftmost before those eraser marker, that will be, you know, a graph which will not be connected to something between the first and second eraser marks. Okay, and these graphs, these connected components will have a path decomposition, will have, where every bag is a union of six w clicks. How do I get it? Like, so I just take a look at these two eraser mark, and then take the first row, second row, third row, and that is one bag. Okay, so how many are there? Or like first row and second row, that is the first bag, and then second row and third row, and that is the second bag, and like that. And you can prove that this is a path decomposition, because like there are no edges which are like going from, you know, row one to row four or above. Okay, so this is the proof, right? So you delete any of these labels, like vertices on one particular label, it will have a path decomposition where every bag is a union of order w clicks. Okay, and that's it. Okay, now so maybe I will quickly explain this exact cycle and then move on to conclusion, and I will skip the contraction decomposition. Okay, so let's see how to use exact cycle on unit disk graph. Okay now I will not explain you this the first step, because there is no time. There is a Turing polynomial kernel for exact cycle on unit disk graph. What does it mean? Okay, given an instance of an exact cycle, okay, where that graph is a unit disk graph, and I can output polynomially many instances of exact cycle on unit disk graphs, and each of these instances will have polynomial in k many vertices, and the original instance is a S instance if and only if at least one of them is a S instance. Okay, so to solve the problem, I just need to solve the problems on all these kernels, polynomially many kernels. So you just apply this Turing kernel, and then you will get, you know, unit disk, like exact cycle on unit disk graphs, where the number of vertices on those graphs will be bounded by polynomial in k. Okay, and then look at each graph, you know, each instance HK, and apply vertex decomposition theorem, where you apply with W equal to square root K. Then there are square root K, you know, labels, and look at your K cycle. Your K cycle have K vertices, and there will be one label that uses at most square root K vertices from your solution. Okay, and that label BP, or like that set BP. And now how many vertices are there in P? Only poly K vertices. And how many vertices from P belongs to your are part of your solution? That is only square root K. So you just guess those Q vertices which are from the set P, which is in your solution, that you can, number of choices is K to the power order square root K. And then what you do is You look at the graph H minus P, okay, and it has a 3D composition where every bag is a union of order square root K bags, and to that graph you also add all the vertices of Q. Then that graph will also have a 3D composition where every bag is a union of order square root K clicks, because in every bag you also add this Q, and this Q will form as a singleton clicks. Okay. Now on this 3D composition, you apply your dynamic programming algorithm, and that will give you an algorithm with a running time k to the power order square root k. Okay. So we have seen, you know, a structured kind of 3D composition for unit disk graph, and we have seen how that structured kind of 3D composition play a role in a grid miner theorem, and how does that kind of a 3D composition play a role in a vertex decomposition analogous to the planar graphs. And this portion I skip because already it's 6. Okay, so there is something called contraction decomposition. If you look into the book, the parameterized algorithm book, you will see like contraction decomposition on planar graph. Okay, not very analogous to that, but something, a weaker notion of a contraction decomposition on unit disk graph can also be proved, and the proof is quite technical, and using that one can get a good algorithm for minimum bisection. So that part I will skip. Okay, now to conclude, so we have seen, you know, structured 3D composition where every bag is a union of clicks, and for unit disk graph there is a such kind of a 3D composition where every bag is a union of order square root n clicks. And how does such kind of 3D composition play a role in linear grid theorems or vertex decomposition theorems? And like some of these results can be extended to higher dimensional geometric object. Instead of unit circle, it is like a, you know, unit ball, like in a instead of like on a plane, it is a space of dimension 3. Okay, and similarly, like to the higher dimensions. Okay, and some these kind of structured 3D composition can also be designed for something called the map graphs as well. And so we have seen an algorithm for long cycle on unit disk graph which runs in time k to the power order square root k, but we can get in time 2 to the power order square root k using bit like doing bit more work on these kind of structured decompositions. Okay, it's not completely different. You need to apply some more technique on those decompositions. Okay, and so with that I will stop, and these are the papers in which some of these, like many of those result corresponding to unit disk graph you can see, and the result corresponding to the planar graph you can see it actually in the book of parameterized algorithms by Saigon et al. And that's it. And if you have any question, please go.
Thank you so much, Fahal. And yes, if anybody has questions, they can just unmute themselves and ask right away.
Fahad, the place where you were constructing this part decomposition, there you were assuming that the unit disk representation is given, right? Can you do that even if such a representation is not given?
No, I don't know how to do it if such a representation is not given.
Okay.
That uses that cell, you know, cell partition.
Okay, yeah. So, and you mentioned this theorem 1 and theorem 2, right, in the beginning, how to derive, if you can go.
Okay.
So, there I'm assuming you can still do it without the representation, right? Because you mentioned about this graph G prime, the subgraph G prime with...
Which one? Okay. Okay. So, it looks like that, but the problem is, if you don't have that cell partition, so notice that here you are going to apply theorem 1 on G prime, right? Okay, and if there is a set representation given, this G prime is an induced subgraph of G. Mm-hmm. Okay. But if the representation is not given, that G prime is just a unit disk graph, and that may not be an induced subgraph. So that may not be that is not a subgraph of G. Okay, that is some other unit disk graph. Okay, and then if the algorithm is going to give you a tree decomposition, it is fine. But if the algorithm is going to give you a grid miner, then that grid miner, you are going to get it in G prime.
Okay.
And so it may not be a grid miner in G because it is not a subgraph. Is that clear?
Yeah. Thanks.
So that's the place it breaks.
Okay. Thank you.
There's another question in the chat.
Dominating set, I think it's W1 hard. Presence of clicks might not helpful. Yeah, of course, it doesn't help because you need to know like which all vertices dominated. And any algorithms or hardness, no. For dominating set, for dominating set, it is not that it is W1 hard.
Hi Fahad. So the min bisection problem that you mentioned in your very initial slides, as far as I recall, they have a 2-power order k algorithm on UDGs, right?
Yeah, that's all I know.
Yeah. So but I see that a lot of your for other problems, the algorithms are sub exponential. So can you pull up?
The idea is like. For the main bisection problem, what we need to use is something called contraction decomposition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now in those contraction decomposition, we don't have terms related to square root k, like that I didn't explain in this talk. Okay, so and the contraction decomposition, if I look analogous notions of planar like vertex decomposition on planar graph and vertex decomposition on unit disk graph, they are pretty much close. Like it's like a union of some square root k clicks. But the contraction decomposition, it is not that close as well. It is, you can say it is somewhat weaker than what we get for vertex decomposition.
Okay, but is there a hope of getting sub-exponential algorithms for bisection on UDGs, like without using probably these kind of things or something else, or are there lower bounds known in general?
I don't know even for planar graph, like 2 to the power little of k.
Okay, so even the planar graph contraction decomposition does not help.
So the point for the contraction decomposition for planar graph, you can apply with the K+1, and I don't know how you apply with, you know, and I don't think there is a kernel for mean bisection on planar graphs is known. I mean, somebody can correct me if I'm. I don't think that is known.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yes, okay, like if you, like one of the paper here, like which I mentioned by Marx, there are a lot of sub-exponential. So for example, okay, look at the fourth paper. In that fourth paper, there are a lot of lower bounds proved. And the lower bound is not like, you know, 2 to the little of square root n is not possible. In fact, it is more general, like for a higher dimensional structures, like even for unit ball or not just unit ball, like geometric intersection graphs on even for higher dimensions. There are lower bounds proved with, the lower bound is like 2 to the, if I restrict on 2-dimension, it will be, it is like 2, you need 2 to the power omega of square root n. So that lower bound also work for, you know, in the parameterized setting as well. So since it is a lower bound, so for many of the problems it is proved here.
Okay, thank you so much once again, Fahad, and thanks to the audience for being around.